Hi, my name is Alan McCabe. I'm a National Park Service volunteer here at the Vietnam Veterans Memorial on the National Mall in Washington, D.C. And since 2002, it's been an honor of mine to have served nearly 8,000 hours as a volunteer at this beautiful memorial. Over those years, I've developed about a 25-minute talk where I cover all of the questions that visitors have often asked about the memorial. My goal here today isn't to try to bore you with a bunch of facts and statistics, but rather to try to give you some insight into the history and the symbolism of the memorial, and perhaps give you a better understanding of how this memorial has changed America and changed the way America treats her veterans. If you come down here to the wall from anywhere in the country, there are usually National Park Service rangers here and volunteers throughout the week and on the weekends. We're here to answer your questions, to help you look up the name of a friend or a loved one, or even do a tracing for you of a loved one. It's a wonderful memento to be able to take back home the remembrance of a fallen friend or a loved one. The Vietnam Veterans Memorial has become one of the most visited memorials in Washington, D.C. In fact, we get about 4.5 million visitors a year, about 130 million visitors since the memorial opened on Veterans Day weekend, November 1982. Now, the idea for a Vietnam Veterans Memorial actually came from a Vietnam vet. And that man's name is Jan Scruggs. Scruggs is a Bowie, Maryland native. He was drafted in the Army and served with the Army's 199th Light Infantry Brigade. Scruggs was combat infantry, and he was seriously wounded over there in May of 1969. He came back home, settled back in Maryland, even went on to get a master's degree and a law degree from the University of Maryland. But Scruggs would later write that it was as he was working on his college degrees is that when he began to develop the idea of building a Vietnam Veterans Memorial right here on the National Mall. Imagine what an absolutely crazy idea that was. In 1979, some young guy that thinks he can convince Congress to build the first memorial on the National Mall since the Jefferson Memorial opened in 1943. We didn't even have a World War II or a Korean memorial yet, and here was this young guy thinking that he could convince the world to build a Vietnam Veterans Memorial right on the National Mall. He founded the Vietnam Veterans Memorial, found two very influential senators, Senator Charles Mathias from Maryland, Senator John Warner from Virginia, and those two senators initiated legislation which easily passed Congress. President Jimmy Carter signed the bill on the 1st of July, 1980, authorizing a Vietnam Veterans Memorial right here on the National Mall. I often point out to younger visitors in the audience that it's hard now to imagine just how controversial the Vietnam War had been. Not only was it America's longest war, and no matter what the talking heads say on the Sunday television shows, Afghanistan is not America's longest war. The Vietnam War went from 1955, when President Eisenhower sent our first advisors into the country, until Vietnam fell in April of 1975, a full 20-year American presence in the country of Vietnam. So it was America's longest war. It was America's first televised war. Most Americans were getting their first television sets in the 1960s, and never before had we seen our young men dying in combat in a faraway land. The whole culture in this country was changing. The new electronic media, the music was changing, the counterculture, the drug culture. It was a violent decade in America with the assassinations of the Kennedy brothers and Martin Luther King. There were riots on college campuses over the draft and the lottery. It was a controversial time, and through it all, in the background, was this Vietnam War that was taking the lives of 58,000 of our young men and women. And also, Jan Scruggs had seen how our veterans had been treated when they had come home from Vietnam. Many of them were welcomed home, but many of them were not. Unlike World War I or World War II or even Korea, where there were often parades and celebrations welcoming our troops back, in Vietnam, for the first time in our history, the troops were blamed for the war. And many were not welcomed back. And a number of my friends have told me that they would not even put that they were a Vietnam vet on their resume because they were afraid they wouldn't be hired if people knew they had served in Vietnam. So the war had been controversial, and the last thing that Jan Scruggs wanted was a memorial that would also be controversial. And so many things were done to keep controversy out of this memorial. First of all, they decided that whatever was going to be built on these 3 acres of land would not be built with tax money. Only private contributions from the American people were accepted. They raised nearly $9 million, but no one could ever say that a penny of their tax dollars had gone to use to build this memorial. They also decided not to hire an architect. They knew that nobody would ever be happy, that it was the right architect or the right design. Instead, they decided to have a contest, and they opened it up to all U.S. citizens 18 years of age or older. That way, all Americans would say that they at least had a chance to submit a design for the Vietnam Veterans Memorial. They appointed a panel of 8 judges. You would think that judges for a Vietnam Veterans Memorial would be Vietnam vets. But interestingly, not one of the judges was a Vietnam vet. Some of them were veterans, but it was intentional. The Vietnam Veterans Memorial Fund did not want a Vietnam vet on the panel so that no one could ever say that the design for the memorial had been influenced in any way by a Vietnam veteran. And so it was a blind judging contest, meaning those submitting entries were not allowed to put their name on their entry, but instead were required to put their name in an envelope and tape it to the back of the entry. And that way, you see, the judges would have no idea whose designs they were looking at. Now, if you're going to have a contest, you need some rules. And there were only 4 rules in the contest to design the Vietnam Veterans Memorial. Rule number 1 is the memorial could make no political statement. We'd already had plenty of politics with this war. Rule number 2, the memorial had to maintain the park-like setting of the National Mall. It had to fit in with the landscaping. They didn't want to build another Lincoln Memorial or Washington Monument down in this section of the mall called Constitution Gardens. Rule number 3 is the memorial had to be a place of contemplation, a place for visitors to come to and remember the terrible cost of war. And rule number 4, the memorial had to contain the names of all of the dead and the missing. And that was it for rules. So you can imagine they were going to get a huge variety of different ideas submitted in this national contest. And they did. 1,421 entries came in. The contest ran from the fall of 1980 to the spring of 1981. There were so many entries that came in, they actually had to use a hangar out at Andrews Air Force Base to lay all of the entries out in. Well, the panel of 8 judges spent nearly an entire week going through all of these entries one by one, deciding, I don't like that one, I like that one, I don't like this, and they finally narrowed it down until at the end of the week, all 8 judges had unanimously settled on 1 design. It's the design that you see behind me, the memorial that many of us now simply call the wall. Well, you've heard me describe how they did everything they could think of to keep controversy out of the design for a Vietnam Veterans Memorial. But they got controversy. The critics screamed. When the winning design was published in newspapers around the country, the critics had a field day. Some said it looked like a giant tombstone. Others called it America's version of the Wailing Wall. The Vietnam vets in general were not very happy with the design. One called it a black gash of shame on the National Mall. Another Vietnam vet said it looked like a giant public urinal where Americans could come and urinate once more on their Vietnam veterans. And the criticism did not stop just with the design. The critics attacked the person that designed it, the winner of the contest. Because you see, this beautiful memorial had been designed by a 21-year-old college student from Yale, and her name is Maya Lin. And the critics screamed even louder. Maya Lin was young, just 21 years old, female, not a veteran, and of Chinese descent. Now, Maya was born in Ohio. She had every right to be in the contest as a U.S. citizen, but Maya's parents are from China. And many remembered that China had backed North Vietnam during the war. So you had all of these things going against Maya Lin, but even though she was only 21 years old, she went on to defend this design at a number of public hearings, and in the end, she convinced the critics, at least most of them, that this should be the Vietnam Veterans Memorial. Now, no one should be surprised that Maya Lin was majoring in architecture at Yale. In fact, the story has it that when she and others in her class saw the posters up on campus advertising this national contest, she and others in her class decided to enter the contest and to turn her project in as a school project. She got a B+ on it. Fortunately, the judges thought that it was A+ work. I got to meet Maya Lin several years ago, and I asked her about her grade at school, and she said, "Alan, he never liked anything I did in his class." Her class came down here to the National Mall from Yale, and she later wrote that it was right in this area that she came up with her idea for the design. She really came down here, she said, with a blank slate. She had never read intentionally anything on Vietnam, so her concepts and her ideas would not have been influenced in any way by any particular author. And she said later that it was here that she came up with her idea for the design. Now, I often ask visitors to imagine the land behind me without the wall there. This was just simply a field. And in fact, I think there's great irony in this field being used for the Vietnam Veterans Memorial, because it was this field that was used many times as a staging area for the anti-war protests in the 1960s and 70s. The protesters would gather here to march down Constitution Avenue to the White House or the Capitol. So this was the land chosen by Congress, and Maya Lin came down here, looked at this land, and said she envisioned a giant knife cutting America open. She punctures the earth with this knife, cuts deeper and deeper as the casualties grew, and finally pulls back up out of the earth. By peeling the dirt back, what remained, she said, would be the wound or the scar that had been the loss of these 58,000 young men and women. And I always do the talk up here by the three servicemen statue, because it's easy to envision now the wall as a wound or a scar in America. In fact, the top of the wall is at ground level. The deepest section of the memorial goes down 10.5 feet. So it truly is a cut or a wound in America. Even though the critics hated black, they said it was symbolic of defeat or shame, Maya Lin insisted that the memorial had to be black. As you look around Washington, D.C., it's a city of white marble. Lincoln, Jefferson, Washington Monument, the Capitol, the Archives, the White House, the Supreme Court building, they're all white marble. Here was a black and underground memorial. But she said black is not symbolic of defeat or shame. It is simply here symbolic of earth, since it is 10.5 feet down into the earth. Granite is such a hard material when many of us think of it, and she knew that, and she said that granite would symbolically be the permanent barrier between the living and the dead. We can touch the wall, we can touch their names, but she said that black granite wall would be the permanent barrier where those young men and women could never again enter our world, even as we touch their names. But Maya Lin also knew something else about black granite, and I actually think it's one of the most powerful things about the memorial. Maya Lin knew that when the surface of black granite is polished, that it literally becomes a mirror. And so as you're looking at a name on the wall, you're looking at yourself in their reflection. And Maya Lin said she wanted us, the living, to see our reflection in their names, so that we would never forget that they were just like us. Sons, brothers, fathers, best friends, boyfriends, the kids you sat next to in school, or in your little league baseball team, or the Boy Scouts, or the church choir. We see our reflection in their names. In 1984, President Ronald Reagan spoke here at the memorial, and I still remember a very powerful line from his speech that day. President Reagan said, "Visitors will come to this wall to find the name of a loved one, and when they finally find the name, they will find it in their own reflection." The reflections off the wall are so powerful that you can see the visitors reflected all the way up here on the plaza. So now we know the names are on the wall. That was one of the requirements in the contest, but how are the names listed? Well, Maya Lin did it in a very powerful and symbolic way. Visitors often ask us about how the names are listed. Are they listed by state, the guys from Ohio together, and California together, and Florida together, or maybe listed by branch of service, Army, Navy, Air Force, Marines, and Coast Guard? Or one of the most frequently asked questions, why not list them alphabetically? It would be easier to find a name if they were just alphabetical. But I point out to visitors there are 667 men with the last name of Smith on the wall, over 500 guys with the last name of Johnson. Maya said she didn't want the memorial to resemble a telephone book. What she did say is that she wanted the memorial to tell the story of a journey through one of the most painful times in American history. And so Maya Lin wrote the story of the Vietnam War day by day in the order they died or went missing in action. And I find that is so powerful for several reasons. First of all, it puts guys that fought together and died together, forever together on the wall. A squad in Vietnam may have had 8 or 10 guys, and they could have been from 8 or 10 different states. But if they died together in the war, they're always going to be together on the wall. Maya Lin said that she wanted our Vietnam veterans to be able to come back to the memorial and to find their own place in the journey. So if I know when a veteran served in Vietnam, I can get them back exactly in front of their panels to be with the guys they served with. A lot of our volunteers are Vietnam vets, and I can almost always tell when a volunteer served in Vietnam by where they stand at the wall. And Maya Lin said she wanted the memorial to tell a story of a journey through time. So those are the three reasons: a journey through time, outlined on the wall, guys that fought together and died together, together on the wall, and our veterans to be able to find their own time on the wall. So now we know the names are chronological by day. So where do the names begin? Well, most visitors come in here on this western side of the memorial. It's close to the Lincoln Memorial and all of the tour buses, and it starts with the name John Anderson. So it's logical to assume it's alphabetical and that it starts with Anderson. Visitors who come in on the eastern side see the name Jesse Alba, and it's easy to assume the names start out there alphabetically. But it turns out the names don't start at either end. Maya Lin chose to start the names in the very center of the memorial. At the deepest section, where the panels are 10.5 feet tall, is a marker for 1959. Many folks don't even think we were in Vietnam in the 50s, but our first men went in 1955. Our first two were killed on the 8th of July, 1959, Major Dale Bice and Master Sergeant Chester Ovnand. And they are the first two names on the memorial under the 59 marker. The panels then read like a diary, page by page, line by line, 29,000 names out to Jesse Alba, 25 May, 68. It then swings around, picks up at the western point with John Anderson, and marches all the way back another 29,000 names, ending with the names of our last 18 men killed 15 May, 1975. And so why in the world would Maya Lin design the memorial this way? Well, her answer was simple and powerful. She said she did it this way so that the first and the last would be together. An artistic and symbolic way of trying to bring some closure to a war that had torn this country apart. So it starts in the center, goes full circle, the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end, together at the deepest section of the memorial. Maya Lin said as visitors came in from either side that they would walk down into the valley, the cost of war growing more and more powerful around them, until at the deepest section, where it's a very quiet place, they would meet the first and the last together. To show visitors how long this war lasted, I point out that some of the young men killed on the last day, on 15 May 1975, were just 18 years old when they died. They were only 2 years old when Dale Bice and Chester Ovnand were killed on 8 July 1959. But they're forever together, side by side, bringing closure to the Vietnam War. Maya Lin pointed the western panels of the wall directly at the northeast corner of the Lincoln Memorial. She pointed the eastern wall directly at the northeast corner of the Washington Monument, symbolically cradling the memorial between two of our greatest presidents. I find it interesting that three of the most controversial wars in American history were the Revolutionary War, the Civil War, and the Vietnam War. They're all symbolically tied together by the arms of the Vietnam Veterans Memorial. On the memorial, every name on the wall has a symbol beside it. Most names have a diamond by the name. A diamond means they've been declared dead. But when the wall was built in 1982, we had 1,256 men listed as status unknown. So alongside of their name is a small plus symbol, an artistic symbol of hope. Over the years, we've normalized relations with Vietnam. They've allowed our search teams to go back in, and our teams have found and identified the remains of more than 500 missing in action. And when that occurs, the engravers come back here to the wall in May, and they change the pluses into diamonds. There are now 730 missing in action or status unknown symbols on the wall, meaning that well over 500 have been found and identified since normalizing relations with Vietnam. Visitors also often ask us about the many items that have been left here at the wall over the years. You may go to the graveyard to visit a friend or a loved one and leave a flower or teddy bear or a letter. Well, so too have visitors been leaving items here at the wall since 1982. And with the exception of food and flowers, the National Park Service has kept everything. And I have seen everything imaginable left here over the years. It's all stored in a climate-controlled warehouse managed by the National Park Service out in Landover, Maryland. I've seen helmets and combat boots, flak jackets and dog tags, medals, POW bracelets, sea rations, P-38 can openers, Zippo lighters, 1960s record albums, high school yearbooks, a wedding dress, caps and gowns at graduation time, fishing rods, baseballs, basketballs, footballs, Easter baskets, cans of beer, decks of cards, packs of cigarettes, and bottles of Jack Daniels. Anything that may remind somebody of a loved one or somebody that they had served with in Vietnam. A number of years ago, August of 2008, volunteers came down to the wall on a Saturday morning, and along this western side of the wall, we found a cigar box. And when we opened the cigar box up, inside of it were nearly two dozen love letters that had been written from a woman to her boyfriend in Vietnam. He was killed in August of 1968, and so his name is on this western side of the wall. And that woman had kept his love letters for 40 years. And on the 40th anniversary to the day of his death, she brought his love letters back to him and placed them in front of his name on the wall. On Memorial Day 1995, volunteers came down to the wall and found a Harley Davidson. The Harley, it turns out, had been built by a motorcycle club from Wisconsin. Many of the guys in the club were themselves Vietnam veterans. They built it with donated labor from donated parts. No member of the club had ever been allowed to sit on the bike. And in an interview that I watched with the president of this motorcycle club, they asked him, "Why would you leave a Harley at the wall?" And he simply said, "Well, you know, our club goes out for a ride almost every weekend, and if a brother from the wall wanted to come with us, he should have a bike." The wall's over 30 years old now, and with 4.5 million visitors a year, it's hard to imagine how this memorial could have created so much controversy in 1982. But the critics screamed so loud that it actually forced a compromise. And that compromise was a decision to add something a little bit more traditional, like statues and a flag. So the Three Servicemen statue was added on Veterans Day 1984, done by a wonderful sculptor named Frederick Hart. Hart used three local models, an African-American, Caucasian, and a Hispanic soldier, representing more than 95% of the American soldiers who had served in Vietnam. His attention to detail is incredible. You can see the veins in their arms, and the look in their eyes is just outstanding. And in fact, his attention to detail is such that he even shows one of the soldiers with one of his dog tags laced into one of his boots. And it was not uncommon for a soldier to separate his two dog tags, keep one around your neck, and lace the other dog tag into one of your boots. And Hart captures that. Hart said he wanted the appearance of these young men, but also carrying the weapons of war. They carry an M16, an M60 machine gun, and the soldier in the center with his sidearm is .45. But what I've always found most powerful about the Three Servicemen statue is actually where it's placed. To many visitors, it looks like three young men who have just come back from patrol. They've stepped out of the tree line and they stop in shock, suddenly confronted not by the enemy, but by an enormous granite wall with the names of more than 58,000 they had served with. Others think they've stopped up here, not wanting to get any closer because they're afraid they'll find that their own name is on the wall. The beauty of art is that it's whatever you see in the eyes of those three men. We also had nearly 10,000 women serve in the U.S. military in Vietnam, and we honor their sacrifice and devotion to duty and country here as well. About 100 yards down the walkway from the Three Servicemen Memorial is the Women's Memorial. Dedicated on Veterans Day 1993, it depicts three uniformed American women aiding a wounded U.S. soldier as they wait for the rescue or dust-off helicopter to come in. And even though the soldier seems to have suffered a terrible chest wound, the sculptor, a wonderful sculptor named Glenna Goodacre, said what kept her so focused on the sculpture and completing it was the belief in her own heart that the soldier does not die, but is saved by those women. I recently had an opportunity to travel to Italy, to Rome, and to the Vatican, and into St. Peter's, where I saw Michelangelo's famous work, the Pietà, the Sorrow. And there's no question in my mind that Glenna Goodacre used that image of Mary cradling the body of Jesus taken down from the cross, and her statue here of that woman cradling the body of the young man who's been so seriously wounded. Visitors also often ask if there are any women on the wall. Well, the military's changed a lot in the last 40 years. Now they're in combat roles right up on the front lines, flying F-18s and Apache attack helicopters. But in Vietnam, most were nurses. About 85% of the women that served in Vietnam were nurses. There are 8 women on the wall, all 8 of them nurses, 7 Army, 1 Air Force. They're listed right along with the men in the order that they gave their lives. But around the women's memorial are planted 8 yellowwood trees in honor of the 8 women on the wall. I always tell our visitors to remember that this country and her veterans paid an enormous price in the 20th century, not just for our freedom as Americans, but for the freedom of others around the world. We have no national World War I memorial here in Washington, but remember that we lost over 116,000 in that war that was supposed to end all wars. We finally got a World War II memorial. It opened on Memorial Day in 2004. At the far end of the reflecting pool, in it is a field of gold stars, each star representing 100 U.S. dead or missing. There are 4,048 stars in honor of nearly 405,000 we lost. The inscription in the World War II memorial simply says, "Here we mark the price of freedom." Across the reflecting pool is the Korean Memorial, where we honor another 36,000 Americans who gave their lives to keep the people of Korea free. There, the inscription is only 4 words. It says, "Freedom is not free." And here at the Vietnam Veterans Memorial, the price of freedom is written in the names of 58,299 of my heroes. And I always ask that Americans not forget that this country has now lost nearly 7,000 of its finest young men and women serving in Iraq and Afghanistan. Ladies and gentlemen, we hope you have an opportunity to come down and visit us here at the National Mall and to see this beautiful memorial. On behalf of myself, all of the volunteers, and the Rangers who work here on the National Mall, thanks for visiting us today at the Vietnam Veterans Memorial.